pump it up. Pump up the volume here. Power shift, here we go. Welcome to the video. It's another extraordinary day around the bay in California. Just like, wow. And so we're wowing the whole situation. And we're getting ready for, we are making the power shift. Here we go. Power shift into super positivity. Believe it or not, we are absolutely doing that. So we can take a little while to settle in right here. This is more intense than like looking at pictures on Facebook. It's way more intense, right? Absolutely it is. So those who are doing this, you're getting the power shift, all right? This is strong medicine, very, very strong medicine here. First, we settle in, we settle our intentions. All right, what are our intentions here? Okay, well, let us put it this way. That there are those who say, we got to fix the world. The world has a lot of problems. Okay, so this is the conventional perspective. What are we going to do to fix the problems of the world? Two political parties are battling over, you know, what's the best way to fix the problems of the world? Okay, we make the power shift, which is really no shift at all. No shift at all. Realizing there's nothing to shift at all. And what we say is that there isn't any world. There is no world. Okay, so this is the dividing line. And it's, you can easily tell within yourself where you're at. Now, you don't have to be realized, master, you know, yet. But in your heart, in your the core of your being, your spiritual intuition, you know which way you tilt. You know which way you tilt. Which way are you going to tilt when the earthquake comes? Which side of the fault are you going to be on? A tsunami is coming. A tsunami is coming in the world. Maybe many tsunamis from every direction, actually. And so if you just say, if this resonates, you know, that there is no world, actually, at all. There's never been a world. And if there's something that makes your heart beat faster, flutter, you know, inside you, and you feel, wow, I believe that I can hang out with this. Okay, I believe I can hang out with this. And prove to yourself that you can hang out with it. Prove to yourself that you can hang out with it. Then guess what? You're in the court of the Dharma King, so to speak. In the court of truth, not a legal court, a court of the king, the Dharma King, meaning the Dharma King's grace is upon you. The shift we make is we shift out of the belief that there's any shift to make. So the people who believe there's a world, they're wrangling, always wrangling of what do we do about this world? What kind of shifts do we need to make? What kind of changes? And we realize there's no world. Never has been a world. Never will be a world at all. There's no shift at all to make. Reality is shiftless. Now, it is true. And let's accept this. Let's be honest about ourselves. We're numbskulls, okay? We're feeble. We're feebly chirping like little birds in a nest for help, help. Cheep, 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 cheep. That's okay. The mother bird hears, and mother and father bird hears the cheeping. All right, the mature birds hear the cheeping. And they know, the little birds are, you know, ah, give me a, I need some food. Hey, I'm hungry. I can't fly yet. That's okay. As long as we recognize our situation, which is no situation at all. But pragmatically, it's that we're feeble. Okay. But as long as we're asking for help and oriented in the right direction, asking for help, we're okay. We're going to be okay. It's not required. I mean, I'm sure the Tibetan, the Dharma kings, like Longjempa and Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodo, Padmasambhava, for example, or you could use the other Dharma kings, Jesus Christ and his entire entourage, which is many, and Sri Sri Anand Maimon, Ram Maharshi, etc. They know we're feeble, okay. So we don't have to pretend we're not feeble. We accept we're very feeble, and yet let us be confident in our feebleness. Are not the little birds confident in their cheeping? They say, I'm confident we'll get the response, and I'm confident I'm going to grow up and be strong and be able to fly, right? Yeah, I say, I'm going to fly, but I need a little help first. So this, we shouldn't, you know, we should have confidence in ourselves. I say to Jamyang, I say, I'll do whatever I can. I'm doing whatever I can, and I'll do more to help you out. It's, you know what needs to be done. And I know my efforts are feeble, but I'll keep working and keep improving upon them. Nobody responds, that's okay. I'm used to that. That won't stop me. The worldly people are hoping that somehow hope will be the answer. They're hoping in hope. They hope in hope. Their hopes are invested in hope. Their hopes are invested in hope. We don't invest in hope. We invest in no hope. We invest in perfection. We invest in what is already the case, already true, right now. What is true right now, what hope does that need? It already is. So we invest in it already isness. And yes, our investments are feeble. We're putting pennies into the stock. Maybe we put a quarter. But isn't that how children start out? Putting pennies in their piggy bank? Yeah, it is. And sometimes they put a dime in there. It's like, wow. So we're trying to put more money every day. Can I put a dollar bill in there? Wow, I don't know, it's too much. Put two quarters in then. Every day put a little more in the piggy bank. Of no hope. Not hopelessness, but no hope at all. See, when you believe in hope, you also believe in hopelessness, despair. But we don't believe in any hope at all, right off the bat. We don't believe reality needs any hope at all. So the worldly people keep praying for hope for this world. Is there hope for this world? Is there hope for this world? No, there is no world. It's not there's no hope for the world. It's that there is no world and there is no hope. There's no hope and there's no world. Why do we insist we're in a world? This is a convention. All of this is just appearances in intrinsic spaciousness. Not any different from any other appearances. It's the ego that believes in worlds. So it's not, how do we get rid of the snake that looks like a rope? It was, the snake was never there. The world was never there. We don't get rid of it. As Jesus says, you don't try to make illusions true and then get rid of them. That's the critical mistake that we make. and Advaita knows that. All the great traditions know this. It's the critical mistake is we think first we make the illusion true, and then we find a way to get rid of it. That's the trap. That's delusion. So that's positivity, it's called. So people are saying, there's a snake there, yes, but we're going to find a way to get rid of that snake, aren't we? Everyone goes, yes. That's called positivity. Super positivity is to say, there's never been any snake. There's always only been the rope. There's nothing I need to do at all. That's super positivity. Everything is perfect. So again, yes, our efforts are feeble, but they're backed up by the parents, you know, the parent birds. And the parent birds know that the bird will grow and fly. So we just have to continue our feeble efforts and don't be shamed by them at all. You know, we're the ones who know we can fly. The other ones saying, no, we can't fly. We're stuck here. This is in a world. But we say, no, we're not stuck in any world. The worlds don't exist, actually. No such thing as worlds. There's no such thing as things, actually. And we don't, no such thing as hope. So we don't struggle with what we say here. When we're practicing super positivity, there's no struggle. We don't allow ourselves to struggle. Okay, so this is full stop in the wow approach, which, by the way, the Tibetan masters, the Dharma kings, and all the Dharma kings, but Tibetans in particular, I'm highlighting because they're the ones who have been most responsive. They love full stop in the wow, walking together in the wow. They love it. They love it. This is the right approach. They likely had a strong hand in helping this along, nourishing this along. Because they are the practice masters, actually. Now, there's a growing tendency to lap into silence for me. I have to fight against it. Are there any troubles in the world? There's not even a world. So how could there be troubles in the world? There's no troubles at all. I've never experienced any troubles. I've never experienced the trouble of a world at all. This is true. What I am, there's an imaginary self experiencing imaginary troubles, but it has nothing to do with what I am. It has nothing to do with my reality whatsoever. My reality has never experienced any troubles. It is not experiencing any troubles now. Now, this may sound similar to like New Thought. Well, it is very similar. New Thought was on the right track, for sure. It got sidetracked a little bit. It is being sidetracked right now into abundance belief. Okay, that's a side trip. We can have an abundant world. That's positivity. Let's get side. You know, it's easy to lose your way into positivity. As soon as you go into positivity, you've lost your way, and you will find it will compound upon you, severely compound upon you, and then the whole thing goes downwards. This is the trap, okay? In this world, it's a very insidious trap, you might say. It sneaks up on you like a snake sneaks up upon you. That's why they use the symbology of a snake, and delusion, is that it may start out saying, well, this is really positive, a lot of positivity. Abundance, abundance in the world. We can have the world, and we can have abundance in the world too. Wow, this is great. Super, you know, we have super abundance. But they mistake super abundance for super positivity. This is the crucial mistake. And then once you shift to super abundance, this is now you're on the positive track, and then the snake of delusion will sneak up upon you. And this is what happens here, over and over and over and over again. So we need the Dharma Kings to keep us on track, because we're very prone to this sort of problem. Very prone. And any situation that arises in this world to help others is very prone to falling into this trap. Very prone. And so you do have to be very disciplined to be able to sit quietly. This is the key discipline. And think about nothing at all. Full stop in the wow. Don't think about what's right or what's wrong. Abundance, superabundance, positivity, super positivity. Nothing at all. And this sitting quietly enables you to gather your will and your nerve and overcome the shock of the wow. Because when you're doing it right, there's the shock of the wow. And if you don't recognize the shock of the wow, you're going to then be tempted by positivity, abundant positivity. Okay, so the trap is between abundant positivity and super positivity. And when we go into super positivity, we will have a wow reaction. Super nice breeze right here, as a matter of fact. Wow. Whoa, what a gorgeous day it is around the bay. Wow. It's just surreal, actually. These floating clouds and the breeze, and it's just, it's intoxicating day. So we are right on it here, okay? Just realize this, we're right on it. Thank all praise and homage to the Dharma Kings for keeping us on track. And so before we jump any further, we just wow it. Wow the fact that we're right on it. We're right on the key trouble, okay? It's right here. So wow the fact that we've been able to bring it into focus before we try to dissect it or say anything about it. First, wow this fact of discovery. You see how precise we are in using the right tool and not a clumsy tool. Very precise is we when we discover some very important root, we don't go any further at that point. First, we wow our discovery, the fact that we have been so determined and we must have really been doing great work to get to this clear recognition. So first, pat yourself on the back and allow yourself to feel this wow. This is great restraint, isn't it? But we do this because of our discipline. I say the best practice is everyday practice. This enables us to hit the brakes for like this. And hitting the brakes like this is what enables us to then really, really succeed in the way we need to succeed. Because we understand if we rush forward in the wow, when we're in the wow, we rush forward, we become susceptible, vulnerable to the abundance of positivity teachings. And there's so many out there, and they're constantly scavenging like yellow jackets for you. They will find you. If you're vulnerable, they will find you. Or you will find them. And it's a marriage made in hell, actually. We might wonder, why are we in such dire straits? Right now. The Sultans of Swing right now. Very dire straits, and because we've followed too much of this abundance of positivity teachings, abundance of positivity, this is what's gotten us in trouble. We're way overconfident. We're super materialistic. We believe in abundance of positivity. And that snake has crept up upon us now. The snake has crept up upon us. And you're feeling the snake in the world now, aren't you? The snake in the grass is suddenly, it's right there. And you say, uh-oh, I'm going to get bitten by it. So, wow. You see, we're not in too much of a hurry here, are we? We have desperate determination and urgency. But because of that, we know that just because we're not in too much of a hurry right now, that we will continue following up on this. So you see how you can stay relaxed and just keep cruising. Even though we've come upon this extraordinarily important issue, we're still just cruising, we're relaxed, we're in no hurry. Now, if you only give 10 minutes to something out of your day, you'll be desperate hurry and you'll try to seize upon it. This is what causes the trouble. But for us, and for me in particular, I'm saying, I'm 24/7 now. So I'd never stop working on all this. 24/7, which we need to be 24/7 now. So I'm not concerned about grasping this. I just letting the familiarity settle in. That's all. Let the familiarity settle in. It's very profound. So the shock of profundity, we have to just get used to it. It's like I just hit my drive 330 yards. And instead of running down the fairway, you know, shouting and, oh, okay, I gotta tackle this course now. No. I just sit there. I just say, wow. Don't rush into anything at this point. When the wow arises because of some mighty insight that we've had, we don't rush into anything else. So we're willing to stop right now. This is what's unique about this path. You don't see it anywhere else, hardly. Very, very rarely. Some of the good satsang teachers will do it. Organically, it arises. But they're willing to just stop everything right now. The satsang, everything that's going on, it just goes right into the well. And, you know, people have come, they've paid their money, they're there, they want. This is a problem with paying money to go see a satsang. Okay, it's a big problem. This is why the Dharma Kings, you hear them saying it should be free. It should be free. There should be no charge at all. Because if people paid money, they want to get, you know, hurry up and get, we want the meat, throw us the meat. And if suddenly the teacher just stops. The Dharma Prince, just the wow has arisen. Boom. I can feel it. We're not doing anything more right now. And the people start murmuring and say, hey, you know, we want our money back. It's like that George Jones concert where people paid good money. I don't know what it was. It was like maybe $75 or something. For me, that was like all the money I had in the world. And he can't sing. People are really upset. But for me, it was just the opposite. I said, this is like a once-in-a-lifetime event here. You'll never be duplicated. This is even better than him singing. Yeah, I would have liked to hear him sung. But this, in a funny way, this is even better. Because he's so great, he doesn't even need to sing. We know how he sings. He's sung for us for 50 years, okay? So if he can't sing today, let's. This is our opportunity to start cheering him, even though he can't sing. Because they said, one day, George, you won't be able to sing. We know that. But you know what? You won't be forgotten. We're not going to forget you. Because, you know, he was getting towards the end, and he's passed on now. But he's not forgotten at all. For those of us as fans, we don't forget. We still listen to his music all the time and sing along with it. I sure do. voice of clarity, voice of clarity, singing wise. So the Dharma Kings won't forget us if we just stop right now. Do you think they'll abandon us? Say, hey, I wanted him to glorify me by giving out all this information, you know, and show how so many insights, so many insights, so many insights. Oh, he stopped. He went one insight and stopped, you know. No, no, I want to be more glorified than that. No, 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 just the opposite. They support the ones who are willing to stop like this. It's like we're running up a mountain and suddenly we stop. Because suddenly we viewed something. We've already gone so high up. We suddenly view something and say, oh my gosh. I just ran up half the mountain without any trouble. Oh my gosh. You know what? You say, look, if I ran up half the mountain without any trouble, I know the rest of the mountain's not going to be any trouble either. But right now, I need to realize this fact, and this realizing this fact is the only thing that can stop me from getting to the top of that mountain, because I'll wow it to such an extent, I'll become vulnerable. Just before I get to the top of the mountain, I'll become vulnerable to abundance of positivity. I'll become vulnerable to that. There's a potential, a strong potential for that. It's hooked many, 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 many throughout history. Which is why we have so few Dharma Kings, so few enlightened ones. Because right before you get to the top, you lose your nerve. You say, hey, wait a minute. Abundance of positivity seems just as good as super positivity. I don't see much difference. And I could have the world and be happy also. I don't really need to realize there's no world. Hey, okay, so This is the trap. So we stop halfway up like this. We just stop. Say, hey, let's just stop here. See, this is what takes the integrity, is to stop. This is what we've been working on. The capacity to stop like this is the real path. This is the successful path. So this is the entire approach that we have. We can run up the mountain, and we're real powerful in doing so, but we stop halfway up. We stop and say, look at the view we have. Wow. Look how far we've come so easily. Wow. And then let it sink into us. Hey, I'm going to be able to run to the top. So what are we looking at the top? We're looking at this recognition that we've been deceived by abundance of positivity. This is the deception. So before we run up to the top, let us sit here halfway up and just let it all settle in. Most are not used to this way of practicing. And it's been available here for years, hasn't it? If there were those who ripe, the Holy Spirit would have sent them here. So there's not a lot of ripeness for this. And yet, perhaps if it's made more clear and we become more desperate, there are those who say, okay, let's commit to this. We must commit. Don't wait until the dust is settled to commit. A severe dust up is coming in the world. Do not follow the events at all. We already know. I already know ahead of time. It's massive dust storm, so to speak. And so there's nothing to follow. We're not following it. We're preparing for it so that we don't get the dust in our eyes. That we're not waiting for the dust to settle. When we wait for the waiting for the dust to settle, that's the wrong approach entirely. Meaning there's a terrible, you know, earthquake and so much dust and, you know, just stuff. And you're waiting, can't see, and you're waiting for the dust to settle. It might take a long time for the dust to settle. When the dust finally settles, you look around and say, oh my gosh, this is terrible. So we're not going to wait for the dust to settle. We already know it's terrible. See, they're hoping maybe when the dust settles, it won't be so bad. No, it's going to be bad. Okay, so this is key. Don't wait for the dust to settle. It's bad. Don't be curious about it. Curiosity killed the cat. You must recognize the cat within you and pick it up and say no. The cat said, I'm curious. No, not this time. Maybe next time, maybe. Not this time. I'm not curious to see what happens once the dust settles. Abundance of positivity has to compare it to super positivity. We are going commit. When I say commit, commit, commit. I put a picture up on Facebook. Very, very beautiful. Everything was done just right. There can't be any aesthetic complaints at all. Aesthetically, everyone you would think would like it, but almost no one has liked it at all. Just only the intrepid ones, because it says, "Don't wait until the dust settles. Commit." There's that word commit. I think they're phobic. They're commitment phobic, because they're saying, "Yeah, there's so many nice abundance of positivity teachings out there, you know." You know, maybe one of them, you know, will work for me. I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait a little longer. I'm going to keep. Okay. So, we're not waiting for that, because we already know that that is the key sidetrack. Abundance of positivity. That's the key where we, that's how we go off track. And again, it can seem very seductive at first. Throughout history, we've had so many examples of this, and seeing people be seduced throughout history. Why should we be seduced now? It takes an effort of will. Just say, I decided not to be seduced. I'm not going there. I'm committed to super positivity, no world at all. No hope, no world. No hope is the right hope. No hope is the right hope. And don't hope that you can have a world and not suffer from this attachment. Right away, as soon as you believe you have a world, you're afraid of reality. Because in reality, there's no world. So you think reality is going to take the world away from you. So right away, it's a fear-based situation. As soon as we value anything, it's fear-based. We immediately shift into fear-based, and we shifted into abundance of positivity, hope. Abundance of positivity, hope. We've shifted into hope. As soon as we value anything, we've shifted into hope. We shifted into valuing, to fear. We've shifted into fear, into valuing, and into hope. And the hope then will have us pursuing abundance of positivity. Just like that. It follows automatically. feel better today because I didn't work out so severely yesterday, and I did a lot of flexibility, and today just flexibility. I'm feeling, my body feels okay. It's not so wiped out. Now, it's okay to sample the abundance of positivity. It's just so you don't so easily hooked on it. So you do, you know, the health food nut thing. Yeah, you get. I get like these vitamin supplements. I don't take them. I might take one time and I didn't stop. It's not. I just do it so I can say, okay, I bought the product. I have some. If I really have to take it, I could. Right? Yeah. So when the health nuts, you know, the positivity, you know, abundance of positivity, say, yeah, oh, this is the answer. Oh, if you did this, you'd be happy. This is how you get abundance of positivity. And that's what you need. I could say, I already know what that's about. I have some. I'm not going to take it right now, but I might take it later. And it just sort of it eases your way past all that. You don't get hooked by it. Don't get hooked by it. And you don't get hooked by avoidance either. You know, abundance of avoidance, abundance of negativity. Don't get hooked by that either. Abundance of negativity, neither abundance of positivity nor abundance of negativity, nor a combination thereof. Okay, none of those. So don't get hooked by the grunge thing. That can sneak up on you as well. You get the backlash thing, like, oh, this abundance of positivity didn't work. Well, I still need abundance of something, so let me have abundance of grunge, you know, and misery and stuff. It's the same trap. So I got some was this aloe vera drink or something? That's the, you know, the health. Aloe vera. It'll cure everything. You know, superabundance of positivity. It's not just super positivity, but superabundance of positivity. See the difference? Cannot miss that difference. It's all important. It's a heavenly day here, really. Wow. This is why I like summer. I love summer. Because you can get these moods and it's just, everything's so green, right? And fruiting and intense. And it just seems like everything is alive, so to speak, eternally alive. But again, we have to be careful. This isn't just an abundance of a superabundance of positivity. But it does echo. It echoes to. It's echoing something to us. Okay, so we have to realize it's a feeble echo. Yes, it is. And don't get caught up in it. My way of experiencing right now reminds me when I was maybe 9 years old or something like that, I'm reminded of my youth. I say, oh, this is how I used to experience. There's a spaciousness to everything. It seems as though there is. Who said you can't go back again? You see, there's always the superpositivity of intrinsic spaciousness. And we cannot speak of it as if it were a thing that we could have an abundance of it. This is the trouble, is it not? Do not words mislead us severely? Are not words always a restriction, a quantifier in some way? Absolutely are. Even if we say, though, there's a superabundance of inherent spaciousness, is that not very misleading? Yes, it is. This is why Jesus says, journey beyond words. Nisargadatta Maharaj hammers us with this, ceaselessly hammers us with this. We need these reminders. There's not a superabundance of intrinsic spaciousness. There's just simply the superpositive fact of intrinsic spaciousness. So the power shift is to go from trying to be aware of superabundance to shift into simply superpositivity. And we're reluctant to shift off of superabundance because they say, well, there's so much there. There's so much spaciousness there. Where's there? See, there's still a there-ness. In superpositivity, there's only the nowness. There's only the isness, the here-ness. There's no quantifier at all. This is the difference. Profoundly important difference. And so we're just sitting here, as Krishnamurti said, we're just sitting here, we're meeting an understanding or we don't meet at all. There's no disciple, devotee, so to speak. We're looking at this together. There's nothing wrong in terms of the Dharma kings of seeing ourselves as their disciples or something. Okay, associates. We're associates. We associate with them. We're associates. But Krishnamurti's point is well taken. We're not meeting with words. Okay, we're meeting in true understanding here. Beyond the words. And we either meet beyond the words or not at all, actually. It looks like a winter's day, except it's in summer. It's a wonderful juxtaposition. So let's just keep wowing it here. No hurry. Trust it. When I say trust it, have this desperate determination to not be in too much of a hurry. And when you have this, you're able to see the key insights, because you won't force it. you can't force the key insights. You have to be very disciplined when you get to these key insights like this. It's not quite being nonchalant. You're desperately determined. You feel the urgency, except you know, I'm teetering on the edge here. I've got to just be calm here, and be and just don't push it, don't force it. Be in no hurry at this point. Hurry up and wait. Hurry up and wait. It's like you're in the mountains, like the Sierra Mountains, and yet we're not. We're here in the comfort of ground level, which I enjoy. I'm not a big mountain person so much. The wind whistling through the pine trees, the cool breeze in the hot summer, in the summer, and you're up there at Lake Tahoe or something, you just feel, oh. But wouldn't it be nice if we could feel the same ambience and be down at our homes, down on the, you know, the valley? But we're feeling it right now, this ambience. Superpower breakfast. Superpower breakfast. An egg, half a bagel, and my smoothie, which was one whole papaya, chocolate, Odwalla chocolate protein drink, about 2/3 of a bottle, and a whole bottle of, I don't know the brand, Energize, some kind of aloe vera juice. You know, some kind of fruits, vegetable, and aloe vera juice. It's supposed to be a super healthy drink. So, blended that up, drinking that, drank some of that. That's my day. It's very good. It's hard to get good papayas here, so the papayas were not perfect. If you go to Hawaii, you get the real good papayas there. It's just like, wow. Now that is tasty. Mix it up with all sorts of stuff. It's very good. Wow. But we'll get what we can take over here. It's everybody's in too much of a hurry right now. They're in a hurry to get nowhere. They already are nowhere. Why do they continue to struggle so much to get nowhere? Now, if your mind drifts, I got a little fatigue there. Okay, that's okay. Just bring yourself back. I was just feeling some sleepiness and fatigue. The practice tends to. The wow does tend to make us a little sleepy. Yeah, it's stressful. It's the right kind of stressfulness, though. It's conscious stressfulness, purposeful conscious stressfulness. We know it's stressful, so we go into it with that understanding. We don't struggle here. We just stop, and halfway up the mountain, we just stop. Now, we don't set up camp. We don't start making a dharmasala, buildings, and say, okay, this is where we're going to stay. No, we're just catching our wind. Don't worry about the world, the nuttiness of it. Don't worry. That's not our concern anymore. We're committed to realizing there's no world at all. There's nothing happening, actually. Nothing has ever happened. If you're into super abundance of positivity, you want more words, more words, more words, more words. I want more quantification. I want more. Is this not materialism? Of course it is. The fatigue is partly from our old beliefs trying to pull us back into them, our old habits of superabundance, of positivity. So we're experiencing this now and evaporating all this. We're getting familiar with truth, evaporating it here. So when we get to the top, we're not going to be tempted so much, right, at that point. We'll be able to get to the top of the mountain because we're evaporating the temptation as we go like this. We're not just trying to storm the top of the mountain, because if we do that, suddenly all the temptation will be all there as a backlash, and we'll suddenly grasp a hold of superabundance of positivity and think that we got it. We reached the top of the mountain, when in fact we didn't. We came up just short. This is what I have seen, both now and historically, among my contemporaries. And we're all contemporaries here, okay? Let's start, knock off anything else. We're all here right now, are we not? So, quote unquote, here. We're appearance. We our consciousness seems to be focused here, let's say that. So we're all contemporaries here. And so we both historically and now, among all our, at least contemporary scene, the tendency to come up just short And then people think, oh, they reached the top. And they may think, I reached the top. And they reached the top. And it starts out, you know, oh, this is really great, and this is wonderful enlightenment. But somehow it doesn't really bear the fruit, and it crumbles eventually. And you wonder, what happened? Oh, you can't trust the top of the mountain. You see, it's not really that great. And so then people stop even trying to go up there, right? This is the trouble, is you get psyched out. You think, oh, well, it's super abundance of positivity is the answer, and that doesn't work. And so, wow, I guess there's no reason to climb the mountain, huh? No, they came up just short. They tried to storm the top of the mountain out of ambition, you might say, or arrogance, and they didn't reach the top. So they weren't really enlightened. They just had a superabundance of positivity. And that can play out in many, many different ways. It can play out through all sorts of quasi-spiritual powers and effects and experiencing and all this kind of stuff. Okay, we know that historically and contemporarily. It can play out that way. This is why the Dharma King's advice is don't pay attention to psychic powers and all these spiritual experiences, and don't crave them, don't seek them at all. Okay, that's not it. That's not it. If they arise, fine, wow it, but don't pursue it. Do not pursue it. The Dharma Kings generally are very reticent about the powers and miracles they do and all this kind of stuff that arises around. Sri Sri Nandamaya Maharaj, so many miracles. But she's no emphasis or focus or attachment to it all at all. Keeping the focus here, right? Keeping the focus here. My head's starting to hurt with the hat and the. Let me one second. Yeah, hats can hurt, can't they? So again, any insight that is so important, do not be in too much of a hurry with it. This is our path of trusting this. I trust that this is a very crucial insight, very, very important. I trust when we do these videos, something really crucially important will come up, and it always does. Now, those who've come up just short and they're now into super abundance of positivity, they think, well, you don't expect me to realize there's no world. Come on. So you got to accept what my attainment or something. I mean, this is ridiculous to say there's no person, no world, nothing's ever happened. You don't really expect, and say don't value the world, there's nothing to value. You don't really expect anyone to do that. I mean, that's ridiculous. That's too much. Come on. This is deep down, this is what they're pushing, like No, that's not really it. That's it. It's something else. It's you can have your cake and eat it too. And of course, we all like to hear this. Like, oh, good. I mean, I don't have to put in all this effort. I mean, oh, okay. We just well, you know, how have we ended up? You know, everyone's ended up on pills, haven't they? Just look at the world and how that philosophy has ended up is materialism. So they were in too much of a hurry. Spiritual egotism was in too much of a hurry. They wanted to be seen as, you know, teachers. Right now, I want to have a whole life of why? Because they were after superabundance of positivity. They could get a lot of, you know, devotees who pour all their time and effort and money into what they're doing, and they can jet set around the world, and they can have, you know, palatial retreats everywhere, and be treated like a, you know, rock star everywhere, and live the life of superabundance of positivity. So they give the impression of dashing up the mountaintop, and they give the impression of reaching the mountaintop, but they didn't really reach it. Probably never intended to in the first place. Some may have intended to reach it, and they you know, lost their nerve, and they just kind of crumble away, or recede into the background. But others take on the rock star thing. They're not really rock stars. Nothing wrong with spiritual rock stars. We need them. But there are just some that are not really rock stars who have the trappings of it, but are not. Don't get caught by the opposite grunge thing, like, oh no, the spiritual rock stars, they're terrible, that's all terrible. No, it's not, they're not terrible. It's just the posers are have to be seen as just posers, and that is there's into super abundance of positivity instead of super positivity. Already into July. That is crazy. What happened to June? Wow, the summer is going too fast. I want the summer to slow down. I don't want to be in any hurry for summer to end. I want it to last forever, actually. Again, this is so important. Do not be in a hurry to dispense with this effort. This is the key to getting the mountaintop is to not be in too much of a hurry. Be very wise about it. This familiarity has to set in like this. We have to get comfortable with these recognitions, very comfortable with them. Feels like Hawaii right now here, actually. Minus the humidity. Minus the aggravation of going to Hawaii. And the expense. I talk to people who go there. Oh man, the food. You dine out in nice restaurants. Holy cow. Get crushed financially there. Just crushed. It's tough when you have a little bit of money because you always want to have more. It's better to not have any. Then have just a sort of a medium amount, kind of, because you know it's like I went to Hawaii for we stayed here for like 5 days, but it just wasn't long enough, you know. Just you need at least 10 days there really to settle in, you know, 10 days. But it was just too expensive, the restaurants and stuff, and so you're always like worried, you know, like you're almost there but not quite, you know. You don't quite, if you don't have any money, you don't even worry about it. Just, it's just, you know, out of mind, really. I don't give thought to going places at all. Almost none. Almost none. It's better. It's better. You don't worry about, well, okay, what restaurants can I eat in and how much can I eat? You're always thinking, budgeting. Can I make this? And it's never quite grand enough, you know. It just doesn't, the super abundance of positivity, you think, oh, it's just the rainbow is always receding, you know. Oh, almost there. Oh, it's such a beautiful rainbow. And of course then the wealthy, the rich, what are they obsessed with? Getting richer, because they see, wow, I'm rich now, I could really have a super abundance of positivity, but I'm being so successful getting rich, why not just get even richer? Seems like I'm on a roll. Why stop now? It's like the gambler. They're winning all the hands. They say, why stop now? So they can't stop. They're always so busy. It's amazing. Constantly organizing, planning, organizing the wealthy people. Maybe they'll take a break, but have some tea or something. But oh, mama, someone calling me, texting, you know. Do they ever do what we're doing right here? Do they ever do? 1 minute. Okay, the mail's being delivered. Do they ever do what we're doing right here? And I would submit to all of you that this is real riches right here. This is the real rich lifestyle. We're princes. We're Dharma princes here. I mean, this is the lifestyle of a Dharma prince, what I'm doing right here. Absolutely it is. I'm actually taking the time to hurry up and wait. You don't see the wealthy doing this, actually. When they're on their retreats, where's their mind? Making their next $10 million. The houses they're building. The trouble they're having with the hired help and the servants, you know, the shopping that the family wants to do, you know, what's the next trip? Do they ever take time like this? I don't think, we're like some of the few people in the world that actually take time like this, spend time this way. Very few do it like this. It's a super blessing of what we're doing, actually. This is genuine high aristocracy right here. This is being in the court of the Dharma kings right here. Hurry up and wait. The tortoise and the hare, both. We hurry up and then wait. This is astonishingly rare. To see anything, to experience and participate in anything like this. Astonishingly rare. Most people don't even know how valuable it is. Jesus said, don't put your valuables before the barnyard animals. I mean, cast not your pearls before swine. Yeah, we keep Jesus in the house always, you know. To leave Jesus out is extremely foolish. Many think that that shows how smart and hip they are. No, it doesn't. How spiritually hip they are. There's no spiritual hipness in leaving Jesus out. Ram Maharshi didn't leave Jesus out. Many believe that Jesus traveled to India in his lost years. People didn't know where he was. He went with his uncle, Joseph Arimathea, trading spices to India. And that when he was in India, then he stayed there and studied under the rishis and the gurus. Okay? And you hear some of these stories recounted with glee that you know this is where Jesus got his, you know, all his teachings. The Dharma. He came here to learn the Dharma. That's then he came back and taught people in the Holy Land the Dharma. Well, how do we not know that actually Jesus went to India? Okay, let's say he went to India. Maybe he went to India to teach the Dharma. And that's never mentioned, is it? But we're mentioning it right here. Did Jesus, maybe he went there to teach the Dharma to the people there and to the gurus and the sadhakas, etc. Keep in mind that Jesus, at a young age, was in the synagogues teaching the people and the rabbis and the bigwigs of Judaism. He was teaching them right off the bat. And they said, who in the world is this? Who is this? He seems to have extraordinary wisdom. So, it's very patronizing to suggest that Jesus went to India in order to study, and that he needed to learn from the gurus there. You know, we think it's very ecumenical to say that. It's not. It's very condescending to suggest such a thing to Christians, that is for sure. It harms ecumenicalness. It really does. Ecumenical is to honor the greatness of all traditions. We don't say that Longchenpa traveled to the Western lands to study under Christian mystics or something. Come on. He didn't need to do that. The Dharma kings are plenty capable of expressing their empowerments. Who did Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma or Ma Maharshi need to go to study under? Who did Ramana study under? So, do we think Jesus Christ needed to study under someone? Let us look at this together. He needed to go to India or Tibet or somewhere, and back then it was India, mostly, and study Buddhism or something? Really? Is that an ecumenical spirit, or is it something else? Sort of spiritual chauvinism, you might say. Well, if he did, he must have had one heck of a great teacher. I wonder who that is. I mean, it would have to be a Supreme Dharma King, you know? But either way, you know, it's let's be clear. That we give Jesus his rightful place here, and that he knows what it's all about, and most likely, certainly knew what it was all about when he came here. There's no evidence to suggest otherwise, actually. There's no evidence to suggest that Jesus needed to study and learn truth when he came to this world. There's no evidence to suggest that. No tradition or evidence of that whatsoever. That he was fully aware of truth coming into this world. Fully enlightened. Totally, perfectly enlightened. He was an avatar, came into the world as an avatar. Not as somebody needed to travel to India and study and acquire this sort of, acquire this knowing. So it's not only the East that has avatars here. Let's be clear about that. Okay. It says Eastern Shamanism. Oh, it says some of the way we have to, must have had to travel the East to get the truth. No. Truth is ever present throughout. It can appear anywhere, any place an avatar can arise. Avatar truth. Now. Is it possible that Jesus went to India? Yes. Is it possible he hung out with teachers? It's possible. Maybe he was just putting his house in order or something, right? So there are ways to look at it that allow for ecumenical spirit there. But to say that, well, we really don't need Jesus in our teachings because he came here to get the teaching, so we know what his teachings are all about because he got them from us. That's not exactly an abundance of caution there, that attitude. That's a little bit overconfident. You know, I would say I would advise, you know, let's err out of on the side of caution here. Okay, let's err on the side of caution. And let's say that let's keep Jesus in the house here. Because he has a perspective that I have found is extraordinarily helpful. And it doesn't come from the Eastern teachings exactly. He actually has his context, I find the overall context is very complementary, but it certainly adds quite a bit, actually, to the Eastern teachings. Some very, very key areas. He's super, super complimentary, super helpful. So again, keep Jesus in the house. I know some of you are. Thank you very much. It's very appreciated. Very much appreciated here is the ecumenical spirit of those who watch these videos and are on Facebook. I find that's a very wise approach. Err on the side of caution. We have a number of Dharma kings here. We take from all of them, okay? And they're all very ecumenical, all of them. We try to stay away from spiritual chauvinism. Without condemning it, we say that, you know, if you're saying we're being kind of cautious, yeah, let's err on the side of caution here. By all means, at this time, by all means, because there's a very strong likelihood that the taint of superabundance of positivity is at play more than we realize here. Okay, more than we realize. So we'll find out how it all shakes out. Okay, so but we are not patronizing Jesus here. Okay, we will not patronize Jesus. with that attitude, a patronizing attitude. No, 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 no. We absolutely bow at his feet. Along with bowing at the feet of all the other Dharma kings. They're in that echelon of, we don't need to compare them. We know they're all incomparable. So I have a tremendous Christian background, just tremendous, actually. You name it, from the great Christian mystics, from Jesus himself, the great Christian mystics, to Christian Science, Mary Baker Eddy, which brought about New Thought, okay, which then ultimately has become A Course in Miracles, you might say. A Course in Miracles sort of is something that New Thought could easily get into, right? Really, it's very similar. It just takes it much further. It's much, much clearer, actually. And many, many, you know, modern Christian mystics. So I have this vast heritage of Christianity. But I also have, probably from previous lives, a vast heritage in the other traditions. And I'm very grounded in many ways. And certainly enough to hang out with the Dharma kings of other traditions. And I certainly can talk that talk and walk that walk. But in no way are we trying to sell our Christian tradition short, which I find the other traditions have a tendency to do that. They really do. They're very condescending about it, very patronizing. Oh yeah, Jesus, yeah, he said some good things, yeah, but he got him from India and, you know, whatever. You know. They don't really know Jesus. They really don't know. They really don't know. They haven't. They just have some snippets of clever condescension. They don't. They've kind of learned how to be cleverly patronizing, slickly patronizing. But I catch it. You know, you can't get that past me. Cannot get that one past me at all. And that there's a tendency, some of these Eastern religions, to be very slickly that way, and some of them in the West too, towards the Eastern religions, say, oh yeah, Tibetan Buddhism, oh yeah, that's really cool, yeah. That also, it goes both ways. And of course the Tibetan Buddhists would notice that right away, so that's just being condescending. So it goes both ways, but it tends to be a little more from the East. A lot of Christians just ignore the Eastern teachings. Whereas Eastern teachings will kind of, they also ignore the Western teachings too. So it goes both ways here, actually. It really does. True ecumenicalism is a rare thing. It's a rare thing. Really it is. But it's the best thing, really. It's the best way. Because it protects you from this, from falling in the trap of super abundance of positivism. It's very protecting. This is what I'm finding. Because if you start getting pulled in one way, one tradition's pulling you in, you can grab a hold of this other tradition, like the Tibetan Buddhist will pull you out of it. You know, Longchamp will pull you out of it if you're starting to slip into it in a Christian way. Which Christianity is very much falling into this trap. As is Hinduism, as is Buddhism, etc., etc. They're all falling into this trap. It's the ultimate trap. It's what you fall into. When you fall, that's what you fall into. So we better be aware of this. How are we doing here? Moving right along, huh? This has been, you know, a lot of effort here, a lot of will to this video, as all of them, but it's not gone as fast as some do. It feels like I've been doing it a long time here because I really have to dig deep for this stuff. We're challenging the entire orthodox structure of at this point. We're calling it all out. You know, it's calling it all out, as we should do. Now, not many respond. It gets them in a huff. They think, no, the super abundance of positivity is where it's at. So I'm reaching out to everyone and saying, I'm not judging. I don't have any regrets. I mean, it's, we had our little tea party. Okay, we've had our tea party of super abundance of positivity. That's wonderful. I've enjoyed it. I think we've all enjoyed it. It's kind of been cool and fun and also terribly suffering all with it. And, you know, enjoyed our suffering too. It's kind of weird. But now it's time to, you know, do gotta be cool power shift. Here we go. Gotta be cool power shift. Here we go. So don't condemn yourself for it. Say, okay, you know, being part of that helped me see what it is. And now I realize I'm really not attached to it anymore. I'm really not attached to it. It's like a phase that we went through. It's a phase that we went through. So the spirituality is a phase that we go through. We call it this superabundance of positivity, we call it spirituality. It's a phase. We need to graduate from that phase. It's like, you know, junior high school or something. You know, you don't condemn yourself, but just don't get stuck there, fixated on it. Don't get fixated. We all go through this phase. Everybody goes through this phase, really. You don't just leap into super positivity from positivity. First, you go through this super abundance of positivity phase, and you think maybe that's it. Maybe I can avoid the continuity fear issues by doing that. And then gradually you realize, no, that's not it. So then you graduate from that phase. So we have to graduate. I'm just encouraging everyone to graduate from this phase. This is what's really hip. Not going into grunge, not going into lack of superabundance of positivity, that's not graduating. Graduating is going into super positivity, which is beyond hope and fear. It's coming out of this mythical dream. We've just been in this mythical dream, is all there is. That there's something other than reality. And in this mythical dream, we think, oh, we can have a super abundance of positivity, and this has this mythical ability to make us mythically happy. So, but it's all myth. It's all mythical. And it all feels somehow vaguely threatened in some way that we don't understand in the dream. We don't understand, what is this bothering us? Well, reality's bothering us. Because it's just, this is, if we wake up from the myth, there's reality. So myth, reality seems to threaten myth without doing anything. Reality's not trying to threaten anything. But of course, wakefulness seems to threaten sleep. So sleep feels like I feel I'm being attracted to something. I'm going to lose everything. Or we're just going to lose our mythical dream, which is inherently fearful, isn't it? So we're going to lose our fear is what's going to happen. So we're choosing fearlessness. We can either choose fear or fearlessness. Choose fear or fearlessness. Pretty good weight today. Pretty good weight. It's sort of like my fighting weight. You know, to make the weight, I shed a couple more pounds. You know, and then I kind of feel skinny. I have my skinniness, and then I have my fighting weight, which is a couple, 2.5 pounds more. Or maybe 3 pounds more than the skinny weight. So I'm not in the skinny weight thing, which is fine. But I try and stay in touch with it. You know, don't get too far away from it. When you're skinny, you feel like dancing. That's pretty cool. I actually learned a dance step today. Simplest all dance steps. Just the tapping of the rear foot, just tap it. I was tapping the front foot, so I asked an expert, dance expert, how do you do it? Oh, it's like this. step, tap, tap the back foot, then step, tap, tap the back foot, step, tap, step, tap. And you just kind of walk this way. So I'm just like, I walk around, I'm just kind of doing dance step, and I'm jiving around, I'm grooving around. I don't walk, I groove. Right? And so try this as you're walking on the beach. Don't just kind of, you know, like, drag your back foot or toe in the sand. You know, kind of step, drag, step, drag, step, drag, like that. Or step, pivot a little bit. Side, sort of, as you walk, kind of walk along the ocean, but pivot towards the ocean as you're walking. Step, pivot, kind of, you know, do something that is not just this robotic movement, okay? We got to get away from robotic movement without getting hooked into super abundance of positivity, which is what's happened in the 60s. We tried to get out of corporate robotic movement, but we got hooked into a super abundance of positivity. All the dancing, everything was happening there. Yeah, we got pulled out of it temporarily, only to go back into it even worse. You see, now we're even worse situation than the 50s. Way worse. We're in a way worse situation than the 50s. Drastically worse. This situation makes the 50s look like it was nirvana, actually. And it wasn't nirvana back then. But this is hell compared to the 50s. And people would say, oh, the 50s was so terrible, it was awful. And the hippies broke through. But they were lacking the crucial insight. But now we're not lacking in it. So we have the experience of the hippies to call upon and say, hey, where did they go wrong? What happened? Now we know. And it's just a simple group. Otherwise, we get hooked by the super abundant positiveness. You know, the go-go girls who you know, can just dance. So the yoga girls who can dance so great, you know, because they're just, you know, their core is just unbelievable. They're so flexible and their core is so strong. And they've been parroting, like, look how I can dance. You know, oh, you can't dance like this. I have super abundance of positivity that get to dance like this. You got to avoid that. The 60s, we got pulled into all that stuff. And you know, there's these dancers, mostly women, they can dance better than men because of the different body type. And they're lighter, less body mass, and they can, their endurance is better. Their moves are better, and so they can seem like, oh, they're just, wow, if I could only dance like that. You gotta be very careful not to fall into that trap. Holy Spirit wants me to do something. I gotta get a selfie stick, you know. I gotta locate some stuff. He's been telling me, you know, show some moves to people. Show what I'm talking about a little bit. I want all the guys to do this. It's little subtle stuff, and you can do it. Don't try to be a go-go dancer. It's not about that. It's not about superabundance of positivity at all. But it is about breaking out of this roboticism at the same time hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait. So maybe I need to start doing some stuff like this. Holy Spirit wants me to start showing people so they get the feel for it, you know, a little bit. And it, you know, it's just spontaneous. You know, it's not like all rehearsed or anything. You don't spend all this time rehearsing dance moves. It's not disco. We're not going into a disco craze here. But you better be able to groove, because superabundance of positivity is certainly going to become a mania in this world as reaction to despair, okay? And the yoga girls are going to be hitting it hard. Say, come on, guys, you know, and girls, they'll hook everybody. They'll try to hook everyone into this. So we want to say, hey, look, I've got my own groove going here, and I'm very capable of doing a little shimmy here, you know? And it's just a matter of not falling into roboticism. It's not a matter of being some great disco dancer, okay? That's not it. That's a trap. It's not about being some dance marathon. So, yeah. Well, let's pray on this. The Holy Spirit can find a way. do this. Yeah. There is a way. I know I have to get some batteries and chargers and other, some sort of camera, you know. I'm gonna look into this today, actually. You can just see, like, you know, the style, the way a movie just, there's something to look at, something to say, oh, you know, can I, and it's about hitting the middle path here through the manias that are to come here in the world very soon. It's about hitting this middle path. You know, yeah, I can sing. I don't have to get into mania singing. I can boogie. I can groove. I don't have to get into a mania. I'm not robotic. Because if you're really robotic, you get shamed by the super abundant positivists. You get shamed by them because they seem so hip compared to you. And then they'll pull you into their thing. And eventually the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll get into it. And eventually it crumbles. And you say, wow, and you burned out, and you missed it. You got fooled again. You know? There's a little snap of the fingers. A little clap of the hands, just, you know, and it's not like this is unique. The super abundant positivists do that too, okay? But you say, you realize you can do it and still stay within this context here of hurry up and wait. And so you don't feel inferior to them. You don't feel like maybe I need to, you know, catch up to them. And no. So this is the illusion that we need to catch up to them. No. We're already with the Dharma Kings. Where do we need to go? What do we need to catch up with? We've already caught up with the Dharma Kings and their associates. So we're already sitting on top of the world. Okay? We're just getting used to it. We don't need to catch up with anyone. When Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodo catches up with you, you know, you're caught up with. You're up to date. Okay. He keeps you up to date. We're staying up to date here, folks. But there's this roboticism of the world where those who seem to be free of it, the hippies, can be very alluring. But we're not really hippies here. We're super hippies, you might call it. We're super, super positive, super positivists. It's not really hippie or super hippies. It's a different thing. Don't expect the old hippie thing to come back. It may come back, but we're not going to go there. We're super hippies. So accept the invitation to be a super hippie. Yeah, I'm stretching. I go to a gas station. I'm doing all this yoga and stretching things, you know. These three motorcycle cops come up, and they're kind of just looking at me. Like, wow, what's this? They got all these, you know, dark sunglasses on and stuff. And, all you know, all the full thing. Thank God we have those who put the fear of God into the thugs, right? The rioters, the thugs, the criminals. Thank God we have someone who puts some fear into them. And but they're all kind of looking at me like, who's this guy? What's he doing? You know. But I just keep doing it. You know. Stretch. And then they see, oh, okay, this guy's cool. He's just stretching. They smile and say, okay, it's fine. It's no problem. But of course they're concerned right now. They're jittery right now. Right. All the police are jittery. Smile. You know. Thank you. You know. Right. It's a tough job. Keeping law and order and putting fear into those. A lot of those criminals, they understand fear, you know? Pretty much so. Scare them, say if they do this, that this can be severe consequences, then that scares them enough to you know, walk under the law and order of the land. You can't just throw law and order out the window. It's anarchy. We're not for that. It was super hippies. We're super hippies. We're not these anarchists, okay? The hippies may have been anarchists in some way. We're not anarchists here. That's stupid. that's really dumb. You know, that's grunginess, you know, that's they're like, oh, you know, we're so hip, we don't even need any law and order. Let's invite all the criminals into the land and throw away law and order, and yeah, let's wallow in the mud. You know, no, we're not wallow in the mud hippies here. We don't need hippies to be hip, okay? We're super hip. We're a superstar. We're superstars. Yes, we are. You know, pump it up, pump it up, yeah. We're already pumped up. We're already superstars. Okay, so start saying this. I'm already a superstar. So, I put this stuff on Take Satsang Facebook page. I have the what is it? Facebook/Clarity Ross. I think it is. Yeah, Facebook/Clarity Ross. And then I have these various pages. I can't keep up with all of them, but right now the one I'm boosting the most is Take Satsang. Take Satsang. Don't take drugs. Don't take sex, drugs, rock and roll. Take Satsang. So I post these posters up there, which you know, in that say stuff in some writing. And so let's start accepting the fact. No, we're super. We're already superstars. I'm a superstar already. Say, I'm a superstar. I'm super hip. I'm already super hip. And I'm just kind of accepting this fact. I'm already super hip. I'm already a superstar. It's called big time in the world. You got to big time the world because the world's trying to big time us. Super abundant positivity is trying to big time super positivity. It was no. It's super positivity that big times super abundant positivity. Okay, let's not get it backwards here, folks. The world loves to get it backwards, completely backwards. I've noticed this, but they like to do it in a slick, semi-hip way, as hip as they can possibly be. Yeah, I'm really hip. I got it backwards. I'm getting it backwards. That's really hip. Wow. So we can't let them get away with that, can we? In terms of our awareness. So we're already superstars here. So I invite everybody to go to the Take Satsang page. It's off of the... And then liking it so it shows up in your newsfeed. So whatever I post on there, you know, you've got it in your newsfeed. Now, I know some of you don't do Facebook. Congratulations. I didn't for a long, long time, and I can understand why you wouldn't do it, for sure. But it's possible to have good stuff on there. You know, in the interaction, the commenting interaction gives a positive feedback. I like this, you like this. It does pump us up. It does pump us up. I don't want anyone to feel isolated right now. I don't want you to feel isolated. But there is this weird culture of, you know, with Facebook. But these pages, you know, you can comment and you can like. I don't think that allows you to put your pictures on there. There might be some place for that. I'm not sure. Yeah, but it's off on the side. It's not on the feed of Take Satsang. But you can like and you can comment, I believe. And you can share. You can share to your timeline. You can share all these pictures to your timeline. These posters, these with some, you know, sayings on them. You can share it to your timeline. And I may post videos of some of the groove we got going and some of the style, some of the groove. So you feel like, you know what? Because everybody is going to dress in some way, right? So we make choices how we dress. So everybody has some style. So in the back of our mind, we say, what's my style? Well, okay. So why not show some pictures of style? Yes. Why not? We're all going to be moving. Why not show some pictures of moving, you know, of grooving? No, we don't move, we groove. We don't move, we groove. We don't move, we groove. Why not? Maybe some music or something or vocal expressions. We talk, we all talk. We listen to music. Why not at least be clued in? Like, here's something that maybe is going to help you in the middle path of not getting stuck with either the manic fads or the fad against the manic fad. Neither the super abundance positivity nor the grunge movement against it. The movement of no, you know, super lack of positivity. Neither the superabundance nor the super lack of positivity. Do not get trapped in either one of those. This is all important, or you're going to fail. If you get trapped by those, you're going to fail. And failure right now is not an option. Do not want to fail at this point. So hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait. Okay, how are we doing here? Well, 140, okay. I don't know what I'm going to do next. I really don't. The Holy Spirit just keeps inspiring me, and we just seem to be jump, leaping over all this stuff, you know. So maybe tomorrow it'll definitely be even better tomorrow. But again, there's very few who are going to take satsang still. Very few. TAKESATSANG, and it should be on my home Facebook page, the pages that I'm managing. I don't know if it is or not, but there is a link to it below the videos here. But I got to find out more information about that. Or you can go to my main Facebook page, and I keep sharing from Take Satsang onto that page, so you can then click on Take Satsang. You'll see the link, you'll click on it, it'll take you to that page, and then you can like it or follow it. I don't know whether you like or follow it, what the options are on those pages. I'm still not really hip to Facebook, but I can get around a little bit. And this, again, it'll show up in your news feed. I like get up in the morning and I get a blast from all these posts from Ramana and Nisargadatta and Nyingma Masters, etc. And some of those who are sharing stuff are doing a good job sharing. And I get this blast from that. And it's like, gets me going, you know, pumps me up in the morning. Okay, hurry up and wait today. Hurry up and wait today. Today is a hurry up and wait day. So start getting hip to super hipness, or start getting super hip to super hipness. This is really super important. We cannot just ignore it. In our society that we're in now, where superabundance of positivity is so extreme, it's so weirdly and awkwardly extreme, we're not Dharma kings. We got to understand we're still feeble. It doesn't affect them at all. It does pull at us. It does pull at us. So we'd be fools to pretend otherwise. Do not be overconfident. Be humble enough to say, okay, let's get as much help as we can in this mode. And you know, I'm doing everything I can to help out, but there's still a lack of interest in it. And we're getting some help. One of the viewers, a Space of Allowance here, is doing some artwork that I'm sharing to. I can share to the Take Satsang timeline. I'm able to do that because I'm administering the page. So I believe I was able to take. Space of Allowance is doing this great artwork. Okay, very, very hip, super hip. Very super hip. You know, it has the right super hipness to it, which is great. So I'm sharing that onto Take Satsang timeline. So if I find something that has got the right super hipness to it, which is not much out there, I'll tell you the truth, very rare, then I can share it to the you know, Take Satsang timeline, and you can just, you know, like that page and follow it, and you're getting this stuff in your newsfeed. And this will be very helpful for you. I hope that, well, I don't know. I just want everybody to succeed. And it's tough that the people aren't doing this, aren't following along this suggestion. And they keep staying with superabundance of positivity. Most are just sticking with that, hoping against hope, you know, hoping that it'll work. And of course, it doesn't. Never works. It never works. And they think you're being negative when you point this out to them out to this. I mean, how is it being negative if you say, you know, driving off a cliff never works out well for you? You know, I mean, that is that being negative, or is that being or saying, look, here's what really works for you? And no, it's being super positive. Here's what super positivity is, what really works for you. That's what will actually work, and nothing else will actually work. oh, that's being negative. We should be able to make it the other work. No, you can't make lies true. This is what Jesus told us in the Course in Miracles. You cannot make lies true. You cannot make illusions true and then get rid of them. It's futile. It's futile. If you believe the illusion's true, you won't get rid of it. Then you think you're being annihilated. Okay? So the fear holds you to it. Okay, so again, facebook.com, I believe, / Clarity Ross, and then see if it takes satsang. See if you can find that on my newsfeed, or if it's on the side there, you can see take satsang. I have other things, the Court of Longchenpa in the Court of the Dharma King. I have the Big Boost and Jesus Has Returned. I have these, like, I think 4 pages that I occasionally post to those pages, but I'm kind of focused on take satsang. Take satsang. Which is, satsang means hanging out with truth. It means hanging out with super positivity. Hang out with super positivity. So again, thank you to Space of Allowance for contributing, and certainly our great poet here is welcome to contribute his poetry. The Bard of Spain, the Spanish Bard, please, is welcome to contribute his poetry to the timeline of Take Satsang, because that has the right ambience for sure, too, doesn't it? Absolutely, it does. So if we can start getting some of these posts on that, it would be, you know, it would be great. But, you know, if that, some don't want to do that, that's fine also. Each one has their own groove, you know, the way of grooving at this point. I find that people have a really difficult time breaking out of their shell of superabundant positivity, whatever their tradition is. It's just like they're stuck in it, you know, and they just don't see what's going on. They don't recognize what's going on. The super positivity, they can't, you know, they don't see it. Oh well, we just keep trying. Okay, thanks to Space of Allowance for being super hip. Yeah, absolutely. Fabulous artwork, extremely unique. Never seen anything like it. That's genius at work. Genius at work. Artistic genius at work. It's not easy to do that, or else people will be doing it. To be so simple and yet get across the point in such tremendous simplicity like this. This is super hip. Super hipness, actually. So, it's a super hip hangout, folks. I mean, don't stay away from the super hip hangout. Start doing it. Don't wait till the dust settles. They say, "Well, I want to see first if super abundance of positivity, how that works out for us. I want to see." It's been tried ad infinitum throughout history. It always is disastrous. Don't wait for the dust to settle.